Thank you for watching this presentation. My name is Arnaud Potier. I am working in the research institute named XLIM in France. And during this talk, I will introduce you some work we have led in XLIM related to radio frequency biosensor implemented on lab-on-chip technology. This work has been performed in the frame of H2020 European project named SUMCASTEC, in which are especially involved these six research labs. This talk, in fact, will specifically focus on a small part of this collaborative work, especially dealing with the development of CMOS chip integrating high sensitivity sensor dedicated to biological cell analysis, and this using microwave dielectric spectroscopy approach. Most of results I will introduce you here were achieved by Ms. Messa Babé during her PhD research led in close collaboration with the IHP Research Center in Germany. So this is the outline of the talk after a short introduction presenting the objective of the SUMCASTEC project and the motivation of this work. We will see how dielectric spectroscopy performed at microwave frequencies can be a very promising analyzing approach to be implemented for diagnosis purpose. Especially combining CMOS technology and microfluidics one can be very helpful to develop new lab-on-chip analysis systems with an advanced electronic embedded. We will especially discuss about an original dielectric capacitive sensor concept operating at microwave frequency with the ability to detect few attofarads capacitance change. And this, thanks to the implementation of an injection lock oscillator design. We will see also some primary experimental result we obtain using some first prototype manufactured in the IHP clean room before going to conclusion. The SUMCASTEC project, in fact, address a challenge to develop a new generation of microwave lab-on-chip dedicated to enable the neutralization of some specific cells called cancerous stem cells, and this using electromagnetic wave stimulation. For such purpose, we propose to exploit the non-thermal effects of some specific EM radiations on living matter to sense and also to stimulate specifically some target biological cell. In this objective, we are work on the concepts that associate microsystems technology and especially microfluidics with CMOS technology. Indeed, microfluidics is a powerful tool that allows us to handle living biological cells and manipulate them easily in a small channel. Now, if we are able to integrate such micro channels on a CMOS chip, we can develop some very promising interrogating platform, as the example you see on the screen here, where we can find on the same chip some microwave sources, some sensors, some wave applicator and associated detectors, and this on a single small piece of silicon. So, why choosing CMOS technology? First, because of its high integration capability at the wafer level, where all the electronic functions we can need to be implemented, whatever in the microfluidic channel, as well just above, CMOS also offer a very mature technology, which is clearly able to address a large market as the biomedical one. In addition, CMOS enables high miniaturization capability of the complete device with a full and monolithic integration of microfluidics, as illustrated here on the technology developed by IHP, where the fluid can flow into the lab-on-chip by injections from the bottom of the chip. So we have here example of very small, very integrating LabOnChip. So now let's talk about motivation. In the SAMcast-Tech project, we address specifically two cancer diseases for which currently there is a need for development of new therapeutic strategies. Indeed, in the case of medulloblastoma and glioblastoma, we are faced to two types of brain tumor that present a high recurrence, relying on the strong resistance to existing treatment. It can be explained by the high heterogeneity of the cells present in these brain tumors. That can be the reason of the low efficiency of standard therapies. You may know that patients suffering from glioblastoma, unfortunately, still currently own a very low chance of healing. Actually, the survival rate is less than 5%, 5 years after the first surgery, which is very low. This is mainly due to a frequent relapse of the disease, despite the disappearance of the tumor after the chemotherapy. As a consequence, for clinicians, this pathology is very difficult to handle. That is why they currently intensively study what can be the potential role of some hidden tumor-initiated cells in order to find some more effective treatment, but they are looking for help. They are looking for new and more efficient integration tools in order to understand how to fight against such cells. They need to know how many of these very tumorigenic cells they are facing and where to find them. Among these tumor-initiating cells, we found some specific cells called cancerous stem cells. CSC are particular high tumorigenic cells that have the capability to self-renew, meaning they can duplicate in other cancerous stem cells. As well, they have the ability to give rise to other tumor cell type. In fact, they can also differentiate into a non-stem cells and so initiate a tumor renew. As a consequence, the possible presence of CSC into, but also outside the tumor, hidden in the healthy tissue surrounding the tumor mass, is currently one of the main hypotheses to explain the disease relapse, and also, for some cases, some metastasis appearance. One main difficulty with these cancerous stem cells is the fact they own quiescent properties. Quiescence, in fact, means that we are faced to some cells that are sleeping. Indeed, they can stay as it, hidden in a niche without dividing. Since conventional chemotherapy or ionizing treatment mainly target cells presenting a high division rate, CSC can survive from this therapy. And for some reasons, few weeks, few months after the end of the therapy, they can wake up and starts to renew a new tumor. As a consequence, we will see here the interest to develop new therapies, especially some therapies targeting specifically cancerous stem cells. A therapy that could push them to die or to differentiate into tumor cells that can be affected by conventional treatment, and so enable a definitive tumor regression and a long-term healing. This is the objective of the SAMcast-Tech project, for which we have investigated a possible selective neutralization using electromagnetic pulse signals. Okay, now if we go inside a biology lab, we can find a huge number of tools that biologists can use for studying CSC, as fluorescence microscope, flow cytometer, PCR, or protein array machine. However, they are faced to main difficulty. Not only CSC are very rare cells, the hypothesis that the number of CSC inside the tumor can be less than few percent, but all the more biologists are lacking from some specific immunostaining marker that could have allowed them to recognize CSC without doubt. They have only several generic markers as this one at their disposal. And sometimes this marker can be also expressed by differentiated cells. Even if biologists cross-couple a panel of such markers to have evidence of CSC presence, they cannot be 100% sure to be phased to a cancerous stem cells using such approach. So how they do to be sure? In fact, they use some functional tests. This is this kind of test that allows them to prove through clonogenicity test the ability of a single cells to initiate a tumor or to renew a tumor mass in the frame of tumorigenicity test. But both are very long tests. They require 40 to 40 days to be performed, and so they cannot be used in clinic. That is why there is a huge interest to develop other approaches, and especially approach investigating intracellular specificity of these cancerous stem cells. One approach can be to use electromagnetic field to identify CSC. Why? Because as function of the frequency, EM field allow to sense some physical properties of biological cells. Hence, at low frequency, this is typically the cell shape, its morphology, or its size on which the EM wave is sensitive. Whereas the mid-frequency spectrum is much prone to investigate the cell plasma membrane dielectric feature. Now, the high frequency allow to have waves that can penetrate inside the cells and probe the intracellular content properties to acquire a dielectric signature that can be specific of the cell properties. And the two main advantages of such dielectric spectroscopy analysis approach are the fact that it is non-destructive for the cells, and also the fact that it do not require to pre-label the cells before analysis. Okay, now how to catch such signature? In the objective to measure the intracellular dielectric feature of a single cells, it will require to use a sensor enable a superior sensing sensitivity. One approach can be to use a capacitive resonant RF sensor, since in such RLC device, the resonant frequency depends on the capacitance value C. So we can use such capacitor as a sensing element as it is done in the example on this figure. Properly designed, such capacitor can translate the dielectric properties of a small individual particles, as the cells here, into a frequency shift and a resonator Q degradation. The trick now is how to measure it. During a previous study, we have used such approach to measure individual cells taken out of their liquid media. Why? Because suspended in this media, the cell influence on the capacitor of this resonator is very small due to its small volume and also due to the tiny difference of dielectric permittivity between intra and extracellular media. So one trick was to measure them in air, letting the suspension medium deposited in drop form evaporate from the sensor surface. The cells have been fixed to handle the evaporation without seeing their membrane breaking. But the counterpart is the fact that the fixation, unfortunately, implies that the cells were not living anymore. However, by this way, And using a bank of different resonant frequency sensors, as you could see on this chip, we have measured the dielectric signatures of different cell lines representative of different levels of tumor grade. And what can be seen here is the fact that the extracted signatures are different between the different cell lines and seems to be correlated to the level of aggressiveness of the cells, which is very interesting, especially if we want to recognize and to diagnose the presence of tumor cells with stronger tumorigenic feature. Measuring the electric properties of biological cells in a liquid media is not an easy thing. It involves several challenges, as having a very good measurement accuracy and stability. As you could see on the work from colleagues from Lehigh University, if you look at the scale of the graph here, you can judge that the influence of cells is very small, and single cells measurements, as in red here, is very challenging. It can require some measurements with averaging and also to be associated with a cell trapping to ensure a stable cell position related to the sensing electrode during the measurements. We can also see that the choice of the frequency, the probing frequency, is not obvious. It has to be determined as functions of the sensors used in order to reach the higher sensing sensitivity. Okay, so once you have identified the frequency at which you intend to interrogate the cells, we could imagine building a system that involves several sensors, each of them operating at a single frequency. This array of sensors can sense a flow of cells flowing into a microchannels, one cell after the other, and as function of the collected information for each individual cell, this system can establish a dielectric signature. For such systems, we see that stopping the cell's motion, in other words, trapping them, is not possible. As a consequence, the sensor to be implemented has to present a very strong sensitivity, implying a attofarad resolutions, since the capacitive influence of a cell emerged in a liquid is typically in the range of 100 attofarad. Now, if with these systems you wish to isolate some cells of interest, once you have identified them through their dielectric signature, you have to associate with the sensor array a cell shorting module, as you have here. Hence, you have the main building block of the dielectric spectroscopy cytometer concept. It is what we are currently working on, and as illustrated by the work of colleagues from Berkeley University, silicon IC circuit design can be a very promising way to perform it. Okay, now, as we have seen, a resonator alone cannot be sufficient to be used as a sensor with the sensing sensitivity we are looking for. So, what happens when we integrate such resonator in an active loop, as here? In fact, we build an oscillator in which we compensate the too low Q of the resonator thanks to the gain provided by the active part. If a cell loads this sensor, the frequency shift of the oscillation frequency appears. And as you could see here, what we could expect as frequency shift can be as low as 500 kilohertz related to the 5 gigahertz initial probing frequency. Now, if we consider two different cells, The difference of biological feature between the cells can translate in slight difference of the electric feature. And so can translate into a different frequency shift value related to the black curve. This difference of shift value directly rely on the pathology of the cells. In this example, if we consider the cell A in purple, that could be an healthy cells, and in green, a cancerous cells, and also in red, another cancerous cells, but showing a much higher tumorigenic feature. We can see here that oscillator-based sensor could be a good approach for such cell sensing, but we have to pay attention on how ensuring the measurement of frequency shift that could be as low as few tens of kilohertz. When we use an oscillator as a detector, you have to face two major constraints. One is the stability of the oscillator frequency, the oscillation frequency, meaning that if the oscillator presents too much jitter in frequency, it would be very difficult to ensure a high detection accuracy. The second point is the spectral purity of the oscillator. Indeed, we are not in ideal world, and we will not achieve to obtain a signal looking as a perfect Dirac in the frequency domain. The sensor will suffer from noise, as here. The noise that could come from its operating environment, thermal noise, electronic noise, and so on. And this noise could degrade its detection capability, especially if our oscillator present a large oscillation peak. It will not be usable if we aim to detect frequency shift as small as few tenths of kilohertz around 5 gig. We understand well here that a fine peak with very low noise close to the carrier will be much more favorable to address such challenge. That is why we propose here to use the principle of injection locked oscillator in order to reduce the fine noise figure near to the carrier. If we consider an oscillator implemented on a chip associated sensing capacitors, the DSP figure here in black in the frequency domain should look to this one. We have a level of noise that will mainly rely on the limited quality factor of the sensing element. Now, if we consider a very pure signal provided by an external microwave generator like this one, to be used as a reference signal, this signal could be set at the same frequency that our oscillator. And you could notice here that we could expect to observe a much better noise figures in green thanks to this pure source. Now, when this source is used as master oscillator and its signal injected inside our sensing oscillator, we can notice here in blue how the sensor noise figure is greatly improved. So what happens now when the sensing and the master oscillators present a different but still close oscillation frequency? That will be the case when the sensor will detect the dielectric perturbations due, for example, to a cell passing above the sensing capacitor. So this perturbation should result in a small change of the sensing oscillator frequency. Basically, under injection mode, the slave oscillator will see a high improvement of this noise figure passing through the purples to the blue noise figures. but its oscillation frequency will also copy the master one. In the time domain, if we look at the output signal from both the save and the master, we could observe here two periodic signals with the same period, but showing a phase shift difference. And this is the phase shift if we consider the Adler theory, which is directly, in fact, related to the frequency difference between the master and the sensing oscillator when it was in free running conditions. We can see also in this equation that the resulting phase shift can be modulated as functions as the injection strength that in fact depends on the ratio of the signal magnitude between injected signals and output signal from the sensing oscillator. Looking to this equation, we can also notice that due to the sinus relationship we have here, we can benefit from an almost linear zone dependence between the measure phase shift and the initial frequency shift between the two signals. So on the two oscillators, master and slave, or synchronized, we can reduce the injection signal magnitude in order to increase this slope of this curve, and so to improve the sensor sensitivity. It will result in the capability to measure a more significant phase shift, especially for our purpose, when the targeted detection sensitivity has to be very high, we will have to favor a low injection regime. So, to design our sensing system, we have chosen to use two differential oscillators. One here in blue, used as reference, and the other in red as a detector. Both of this oscillator will be locked by the same very low noise master oscillator here. Hence, by monitoring the induced phase shift between these two injection locked oscillator, this sensing system should be able to detect very tiny dielectric disturbance occurring on the sensor capacitor with here, target variations that could be as low as few attofarad. We will see all the more the interest to work at low injection regime here when we will have to compare the influence of two different cells that might result in quite small phase shift if the detector sensitivity is not maximized. Okay. So, this is the circuit implementation of the sensor. I will not enter too much into detail. The basic sensing oscillators are here in the middle, are designed with a cross-coupled differential pair, which outputs have been buffered. Sensing capacitors here have been implemented in the microchannel and connected in parallel with differential inductors associated with the MEM capacitors. We can see here a photograph of the chip manufactured by IHP on their SG25H4 BiCMOS technology. We can find here on both extremity the LC tank of each oscillators, and in the middle, the active circuitry required for the master signal injection and output slave oscillator buffering. You can see here the microfluidic channels implemented on the chip with here several sensors implemented in the middle of the channels. And at the end, close to the outlet of the channels, a cell shorter module. Here you can see the test bench we have used to characterize the chips. A spectrum analyzer here and here. used to monitor the sensor running free running oscillation. You can see here the microwave signal generator used to inject the master signal inside the ship thanks to this balloon. The fast oscillator is used to measure in time domain the signal coming out the sensing oscillator and monitor its phase shift under injection condition related to the master signal source. For the ship biasing, some batteries were used in order to limit the frequency jitter that generally appear when conventional DC supply sources are used. On the left, you can observe on this slide the typical spectrum measure on a sensing oscillator operating under free running condition. The oscillation frequency is close to 4.7 GHz. And thanks to the use of battery, the pre-detected phase noise stay quite reasonable. On the right one, you can see how injection locking approach highly improve the phase noise figures. As another example, here is presented the spectrum of the same oscillator, but biased with a DC supply, a conventional DC supply, that result in much degraded phase noise figures. Nevertheless, one can notice that it is also more interesting to use here the injection lock principle in order to benefit from a deep improvement of the save oscillator noise figures, and so a deep improvement on the sensor detection capability. So now, Hans Lockett, if we play with the injected signal magnitude, we recover the Adler theory, predicting that the detection capability can be highly enhanced by lowering the injected signal magnitude that results in a strong increase, as you could see here, of the slope. As a result, we validate here that using a very low injection mode here at minus 50 dB, a shift of the sensor frequency related to the master oscillator one as low as 10 kHz can be well detected around 4.7 GHz. Here, for injected signal power as low as minus 50 dB. On the scope screen, you could observe that the phase shift of 30 degrees, 41 degrees, can be measured when the respective frequency of master and sensing oscillator in free running condition are shifted by 100 kHz. If the frequency shift is now reduced to 40 kHz, the measure phase shift here decrease a little bit to 14 degrees. Now, if we consider both reference and detection oscillator, both locked by the same master signal, without any dielectric disturbance on the detection oscillator, no phase shift is measured since the two oscillator frequency are the same. And a small disturbance is introduced on one of the sensing capacitors, a frequency shift is generated between the two free running oscillator frequencies. Once both are locked, this shift is translated in a 13 degrees phase shift, as you could see here. So now, with an appropriate modeling, allowing to know the capacitance variation which originates the considered frequency shift, it is possible to calibrate such sensor. Actually, for the present sensor, we can see here on the blue curve that a capacitance change as low as 3 attofarad around the overall 600 and 70 femtofarad capacitance presented by the whole LC tank should result in a 3-degree phase shift. That should be the minimum phase shift we can consider to be measured confidently. That means that the effective capacitance sensitivity for such sensor is here around 5 ppm. Okay, it's time to conclude now. We have seen that the proposed design of capacitive sensor based on injection locket oscillator architecture can be used to detect capacitance changes in the range of few attofarad with sensing sensitivity in the ppm range. Such highly sensitive device can find a wide range of application where tiny capacitance change are involved, especially to develop new type of Laban chip systems dedicated to biomedical diagnosis on which we are currently working in our laboratory, hoping to achieve the first characterization of cells very soon. So thank you very much for your attentions, for watching this video. If you have any question, please feel free to mail me. And just before finishing, I wish really to thank our parent union for having supporting this work. Thank you so much.